Welcome to CyberFlow, your one-stop shop for cybersecurity education. This is a 100% free course for the CCNA. Our channel provides courses and tutorials to help you develop the skills and knowledge needed to learn networking, cybersecurity, and ethical hacking. But we're not just about education. We're also committed to making a positive impact. Our goal is to reach 100,000 subscribers and raise $100,000 for St. Jude Children's Research Hospital. By subscribing to our channel, you'll be supporting this important cause and helping to make a difference in the lives of children and families facing serious illnesses. You'll find the links and description. Also, we've created Anki flashcards to help you remember everything you're studying. You'll find them in the description below. Join the CyberFlow community today and help us achieve our goal. Hit that subscribe button and let's get started. The physical layer is the first layer of the OSI model, and it deals with the physical characteristics of the medium used to transfer data between devices. It determines things like voltage levels, maximum transmission distances, physical connectors, and cable specifications. In simpler terms, it defines how data is transmitted through wired or wireless signals. Layer 2, also known as the data link layer, provides connectivity and data transfer between nodes in a network. It enables communication between devices such as PCs, switches, and routers. The data link layer is responsible for formatting data for transmission over a physical medium, detecting and possibly correcting errors from the physical layer, and using its own addressing system, separate from layer 3. Layer 2 addressing refers to the way devices are identified and addressed within the data link layer. It is important to note that layer 2 addressing is different from layer 3 addressing, which is based on IP addresses. Layer 2 addresses are used by devices like switches to determine how to forward data within a local network. Ethernet LAN switching operates at both Layer 1 and Layer 2 of the OSI model. Layer 1 involves physical aspects such as cables, while Layer 2 deals with data link protocols and addressing. Since Layer 1 Ethernet standards were covered previously, the focus of this video will be on Layer 2 Ethernet. In this video series, we will gradually move up the layers of the OSI model to gain a complete understanding of how data is sent and received over networks. So far, you've learned about the physical layer and are now exploring the data link layer, with more layers to be covered in future lessons. A LAN, or local area network, is a network that exists within a relatively small area, such as an office floor or a home network. Routers are used to connect separate LANs. Understanding LANs will become clearer as you learn more about networking. In the provided diagram, there are multiple LANs. The green network, comprising three PCs, one switch, and the connected router interface, represents one LAN. The red network, despite having two switches, is also considered one LAN. Switches do not separate LANs, but can be used to expand an existing LAN. The blue devices represent two separate LANs, since the switches are connected to different router interfaces. An Ethernet frame is a structure that encapsulates data for transmission over an Ethernet network. It consists of a header and a trailer, which surround the actual data being transmitted. The header contains important information about the frame, such as synchronization, source and destination addresses, and protocol type or length. The trailer, on the other hand, includes a frame check sequence, FCS, for error detection, preamble and start frame delimiter, SFD. The preamble and SFD fields in the Ethernet frame header are used for synchronization purposes. The preamble is a series of alternating 1 and 0 spanning 56 bits or 7 bytes to allow devices to synchronize their clocks. The SFD, which stands for start frame delimiter, marks the end of the preamble and the start of the actual frame. It consists of 8 bits and has a specific bit pattern, destination and source MAC addresses. The destination and source fields in the Ethernet frame header contain the MAC addresses of the devices involved in the communication. MAC addresses, which stand for Media Access Control addresses, are unique identifiers assigned to network interface cards, NICs, at the time of manufacturing. The destination MAC address represents the device to which the frame is being sent, while the source MAC address identifies the device that sent the frame. Type or length field. The type or length field in the Ethernet header is a 2-byte field that serves different purposes depending on its value. If the value is 1500 or less, it indicates the length of the encapsulated packet in bytes. For values greater than 1536, it signifies the type of the encapsulated packet, such as IPv4 or IPv6. The actual length of the encapsulated packet is determined using other methods for type values greater than 1536. Frame check sequence, FCS. The FCS field in the Ethernet trailer is a 4-byte, 32-bit field used for error detection. It employs a CRC, cyclic redundancy check, algorithm to calculate a value based on the received data. The receiving device then performs the same calculation and compares the calculated value with the received FCS value. If they match, it indicates that the frame was received without any errors. If there is a mismatch, it suggests that errors may have occurred during transmission. MAC addresses. MAC addresses are unique identifiers assigned to network devices at the time of manufacturing. They consist of 6 bytes or 48 bits and are different from IP addresses, which you configure yourself. Sometimes MAC addresses are referred to as burned-in addresses because they are permanently assigned to the device during production. Each MAC address is globally unique, ensuring no two devices in the world have the same MAC address. However, there are also locally unique MAC addresses that may not be globally unique, but are used in specific contexts. OUI, Organizationally Unique Identifier. The first 3 bytes of a MAC address represent the OUI, which stands for Organizationally Unique Identifier. The OUI is assigned to the company manufacturing the device. Different companies like Cisco have their own OUI that are exclusively used by their devices. This helps identify the organization responsible for a particular MAC address. MAC address format. MAC addresses are written as a series of 12 hexadecimal characters. Hexadecimal is a number system that uses 16 possible digits. The first 10 digits are the same as the decimal system, 0, 9, and the additional 6 digits are represented by letters, AF. For example, A represents 10, B represents 11, and so on. So, a MAC address might look like 00, 1A, 2B, 3C, 4D, 5E, where each pair of characters represents 1 byte, 8 bits, of the address. Understanding hexadecimal. To understand hexadecimal, let's compare it to the decimal system we're more familiar with. Decimal uses 10 possible digits, 0, 9, whereas hexadecimal uses 16 possible digits, 0, 9, and AF. We can see how the digits in hexadecimal correspond to their decimal equivalents. For example, A in hexadecimal is equivalent to 10 in decimal. Hexadecimal numbers are written using 2 columns, where the first column represents 16 and the second column represents 1. This allows us to express numbers beyond 9 by adding another column, just like we do in decimal when we move from 9 to 10. Hexadecimal chart. Here's a chart comparing some decimal numbers, in black, and their hexadecimal equivalents, in red. We can see how the digits change in hexadecimal as we go beyond 9. Pay attention to the second column in hexadecimal, which represents 16. It helps us understand how numbers like 10 in hexadecimal are actually equivalent to 16 in decimal. This understanding will be useful as we delve into more advanced topics like IPv6. Imagine a simple network with 3 PCs connected to a switch. The switch has interfaces named F0/1, F0/2, and F0/3, where F stands for fast Ethernet, indicating a 100 megabit per second interface. Each PC has a MAC address, which I've simplified for this demonstration. MAC addresses consist of 12 hexadecimal digits, separated by periods. While sometimes periods are placed after every other digit, in this case, I've chosen to write them after every 4th character. The first half of each MAC address is the OUI, Organizationally Unique Identifier, which is the same for all the devices in this example, indicating that they are from the same manufacturer. The second half of the MAC address is unique to each PC, identifying the device itself. Let's say PC1 wants to send data to PC2. This type of frame is called a unicast frame since it's destined for a single target. PC1 sends the frame through its network interface card, which is connected to SW1, the switch. SW1 receives the frame and looks at the source MAC address to learn where PC1 is located. SW1 adds the MAC address AAA, AA00, 0001 to its MAC address table and associates it with its F0/1 interface. This is known as a dynamically learned MAC address because the switch learns it automatically by looking at the source MAC address of frames it receives. Every switch maintains a MAC address table filled dynamically in this way. SW1 doesn't know the location of the destination MAC address, AAA, AA00, 0002, so it has no choice but to flood the frame. Flooding means forwarding the frame out of all interfaces except the one it was received on. In this case, SW1 copies and sends the frame out of its F0/2 and F0/3 interfaces, excluding F0/1. PC3 ignores the frame as it doesn't match its own MAC address, while PC2 receives and processes it. Let's consider PC2 replying to PC1. PC2 sends the frame, and SW1 receives it. SW1 adds PC2's MAC address to its MAC address table, associating it with the F0/2 interface. Since the destination MAC address is known, SW1 doesn't flood the frame this time. Instead, it forwards the frame directly to PC1. It's important to note that on Cisco switches, dynamically learned MAC addresses are removed from the MAC address table after 5 minutes of inactivity. If PC1 doesn't send any traffic for over 5 minutes, SW1 will remove its MAC address from the table. However, if PC1 sends traffic again, SW1 will dynamically learn its MAC address once more. Let's look at another example involving two switches. In this scenario, the MAC address tables of both switches are initially empty, so we will observe the process of MAC address learning and flooding. PC1 wants to send information to PC3. The source MAC address of the packet is AA, AA00, 0001, and the destination MAC address is AA, AA00, 0003. PC1 sends the frame out of its network interface, and it arrives at SW1. SW1 learns PC1's MAC address from the source address field of the frame and associates it with the interface it received the frame on, F0/1. This dynamically learned MAC address is also known as a dynamic MAC address. Since SW1 doesn't know the location of PC3, which is the destination of the frame, it floods the frame out of all its ports, except the one it was received on, F0/2 and F0/3, but not F0/1. This type of frame is called an unknown unicast frame. PC2 drops the frame because the destination MAC address doesn't match its own MAC address. The frame also reaches SW2, the second switch. Just like SW1, SW2 uses the source MAC address field of the frame to dynamically learn PC1's MAC address and the interface through which it can reach PC1. Note that PC1 is not directly connected to the interface mentioned in SW2's MAC address table, but it is the interface SW2 will use to reach PC1. Since SW2 doesn't have an entry for the destination MAC address, AA, AA00, 0003, in its MAC address table, it floods the frame out of all interfaces except the one it received it on, F0/1 and F0/2 in this case. PC4 drops the frame since the destination MAC address doesn't match its own, but PC3 receives the frame as the destination MAC address matches its own MAC address. If PC3 wants to send a reply back to PC1, it reverses the destination and source MAC address fields of the frame. PC3 sends the frame out of its network interface, and SW2 receives it. SW2 learns PC3's MAC address and updates its MAC address table. SW1 already has an entry for PC1's MAC address. Therefore, SW2 doesn't flood the frame. Instead, it forwards it normally out of the corresponding interface, F0/3, in its MAC address table. The frame is received by SW1, which adds an entry for PC3's MAC address with the interface F0/3 in its MAC address table. Since SW1 already has an entry for the destination MAC address, it forwards the frame out of the corresponding interface, F0/1, to reach PC1, its intended destination. We hope this video helped you on your journey towards becoming a cybersecurity expert. Remember to subscribe to our channel and turn on notifications so you never miss out on our latest content. And if you found our videos helpful, please give us a thumbs up and share them with your friends and colleagues. Don't forget to check out the links in description for our Anki flashcards and to donate to St. Jude Children's Research Hospital. Your support can make a real difference in the lives of those in need. Thanks again for watching, and we'll see you in the next video.